Hachette Audio presents Unwanted Spy, The Persecution of an American Whistleblower, written by Jeffrey Sterling, read by J.D. Jackson. To the love of my life, Holly, you have given more meaning to this journey than I ever hoped to discover. Who am I? I am the ghetto child. I am the dark baby. I am you, and the blonde tomorrow. And yet, I am my one sole self, America seeking the stars. From Langston Hughes, America. A note about names. This is a true story, based mainly on my observations and recollections, supplemented in a few places by information drawn from public sources. The people who appear in these pages are a mixture of public figures, such as journalist James Ryson and CIA Director George Tenet, and many private individuals. In most cases, the specific identities of the private individuals are not important for you to understand the themes and meaning of my story. Therefore, I've chosen to refer to them by pseudonyms. In some cases, I have omitted or changed places and names after the CIA's publication review process. In other cases, I have chosen to leave them redacted. Jeffrey Sterling. Prologue. Waiting for the verdict. Where am I? How did I get here? Those are the kinds of thoughts you have when your ultimate nightmare comes true. It was January 26, 2015, my second long day of waiting in a small, windowless, soundless conference room just outside courtroom number 5 on the 4th floor of the federal courthouse in Alexandria, Virginia. Over the past 2 weeks, I had been on trial, accused of violating the century-old Espionage Act. As an undercover officer for the Central Intelligence Agency, I'd been involved in Operation Merlin, a covert scheme to derail the Iranian effort to build a nuclear bomb by providing their scientists with fake, flawed blueprints for warheads channeled through a Russian scientist. Operation Merlin had ultimately backfired when the Iranian experts detected the fraud, as revealed in the book State of War by reporter James Ryson. Agency leaders were furious. Not at themselves for launching a risky and ill-conceived scheme, but at the author who'd dared to expose their incompetence. In their eagerness to punish someone for their embarrassment, they looked around for a scapegoat. They found me. A compliant U.S. attorney dutifully filed an indictment charging me with unlawful retention and unauthorized disclosure of national defense information, mail fraud, unauthorized conveyance of government property, and obstruction of justice. 9 criminal charges in all, based on the claim that I'd supposedly leaked classified information about Operation Merlin to James Ryson. The truth is that I did not leak any classified information related to CIA operations to James Ryson or to anyone else. But I am a whistleblower. I'd blown the whistle by suing the CIA for discriminating against me when I was an employee there. I'd also attempted to blow the whistle about the dangers of Operation Merlin, not by leaking, but by submitting my warnings to staff members of the Senate Intelligence Committee. Sadly, those warnings were ignored. I'd been forced to accept some disheartening truths, that neither blatant discrimination nor a dangerous operation related to weapons of mass destruction were matters of real concern to the powers that be at the agency or among the members of Congress charged with oversight of intelligence matters. Even before the trial had begun, I'd known that my prospects weren't good. The world had witnessed the cases of Edward Snowden, Chelsea Manning, John Kiriakou, and a series of other whistleblowers whose prosecution, some said persecution, had been pursued by President Barack Obama with an eagerness that almost suggested a personal vendetta. In the atmosphere created by these cases, the mere accusation of having leaked classified information was enough to automatically condemn someone. In refusing to plead guilty, and instead insisting on my right to go to trial, I knew I was facing an uphill battle. But I could not and would not confess to something I did not do. During the trial, the government did not present a shred of hard evidence to validate the charges against me. Even Judge Leonie Brinkema summarized the case against me as being based on very powerful circumstantial evidence, rather than on hard proof. But there was one incriminating fact about which there could be no doubt. The CIA had paraded a whole host of current and former agents in front of the jury, and I didn't look like any of them. I was a black man who'd dared to try to build a career serving my country as an officer of the CIA. The trial had lasted a week and a half. Now I was enduring the most excruciating part of the whole ordeal, waiting for a verdict. How the hell did it all come to this? I'd grown up as a true believer in the American dream. Work hard, do your duty, and stand up for yourself. Those were the rules of the game, or so I'd been taught. I knew I'd done nothing wrong, and I knew that fighting against wrongs is what an American hero is supposed to do. That's all I knew how to do. That's why I was now clinging to hope and continuing to fight, unable to comprehend how defending my rights could somehow get me branded a traitor. Thankfully, I wasn't alone in that waiting room. My wife Holly and my attorneys, Ed McMahon and Barry J. Pollock, were there beside me. But having company isn't very comforting when you have no words to say to one another. Silence can be uncomfortable, and when it's forced, it can be absolutely nerve-wracking. All of them, especially Holly, had believed in me and fought for me, and I could tell that awaiting the jury's decision was almost as excruciating for them as it was for me. But for me, there was a sharper twist to this agonizing time of uncertainty. More than waiting to learn my fate, I was waiting to learn what my country thought of me. This was a question I'd wrestled with my entire life. The experience was often stressful, even painful. My entire life had been one of fighting against stereotypes, assumptions, and limitations placed on me because of the color of my skin. Something that happened to me repeatedly in both white America and black America. The American dream I believed in and strove for wasn't a white American dream or a black American dream. It was simply my American dream. But to many of those around me, it must not have been the right American dream, because I kept getting into trouble, through no intention of my own. That, in a nutshell, is the story of the events that brought me to this room. My years of struggling to find a place in American society where I could be accepted for who I am. My battle to be recognized as a worthy member of the CIA. My shadowy conflict with people within the agency who, for some reason, were unwilling to accept me as part of the team. The ways racial prejudice continually blocked my efforts to contribute to a cause in which I deeply believed. And finally, the strange and unfounded accusations of having betrayed the country that I love. These memories swirled aimlessly in my head during the long hours of waiting. The room itself was lifeless and almost empty. It was dominated by a table too big for the room, on which lay only a few discarded copies of the Washington Post and an abandoned paperback of the novel Life of Pi, left behind, I suppose, by some previous defendant in an earlier trial. The book seemed eerily appropriate. I'd enjoyed the movie, which had vividly conveyed the message that sometimes the reality of a situation can be so horrible that having a more hopeful version to hang on to may be necessary to make life more tolerable. The relativity of truth, as one critic wrote. Wasn't that my whole story from the beginning? As the second day of deliberations dragged on, the silence was broken occasionally by calls into the courtroom to hear about requests from the jury members. Once they wanted clarification about some aspect of the judge's instructions. Another time, they asked to review a piece of evidence. Then, most hopefully, the jury informed the judge that they were deadlocked on at least some of the 9 charges against me. Judge Brinkema suggested they continue with their deliberations after taking a break for lunch. Maybe there was a chance that the American system of justice would come through for me at last. But by this time, I was too numb to everything, unable to get excited one way or the other. The deadlock just meant more waiting. Holly, Ed, Barry, and I had barely settled back into the lifeless room after a quick lunch when we were told that the jury had reached a decision. My heart sank. I had a queasy feeling that I knew what was coming. We returned to the courtroom. As the members of the jury filed back in, I noticed they avoided looking in my direction. It's like a scene from a movie, I thought. I glanced back at Holly sitting behind me, and I noticed that a couple of marshals had entered the courtroom. I gave Holly the strongest smile I could, and I felt the love she poured out to me in return. When Judge Brinkema asked me to rise, I stood as straight and tall as I could manage, flanked by Ed and Barry. The clerk began to read aloud the verdicts to the 9 charges against me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.